This is one of my favorite plates by Stanley William Hayter. He's a British artist who I've been looking at and working on for about 5 years. This work is from a series done in 1931, six plates about the apocalypse. Yeah, it's a little confusing why he would do this image. Well, in total, they are very surrealist in tone. They feature landscapes that are kind of out of the mind's eye. And Hayter was very interested in the surrealist practice of automatic drawing. And he believed that if he just kept going and drawing and drawing and drawing, something would rise to the top that would, to him, indicate its preeminence. So he had lots and lots of ideas that would float around. And sometimes he would take two of these drawings and put them up against a window, and he would superimpose them on top of each other and play with composition in that way. So you have sort of these two ideas that come together to form an image. In this case, he has drawn for you the void that is formed by the clenching of your fist. That's the totem in the middle. And then around it, with just this very elegant, clear, crisp line, he's describing the hand that is forming the void. So why? So Hayter is, again, interested in this surrealist sort of idea of automatic imagination, where your mind might take you. He also is probably thinking a little bit about artistic creation, and thinking about the hand of the creator as something that's almost divinely gifted from the being, whoever you might think that is, God or whoever. He's also interested in describing something that's impossible to have happen in real life, that you can't really have the void inside your fist be a physical thing, unless you squeeze maybe some clay, which he does do, and probably is something that he used from which to draw this. There's a sculpture of the squeezed part of the inside of his hand at MoMA, for instance. But in this case, he's also giving you the sort of wafty little hand that's grabbing the void. So he's giving you these two layers. As he's creating them, he's also using two different techniques to describe these two different ideas. The hand itself is created with engraving, and that was his first and most loved technique in printmaking. And that's where you would have this diamond-shaped, very sharp, pointed metal tool, and you use it to create this gouging line. You're pushing into the copper, and you're turning the plate toward the tool, so it's a push of this V into the plate, and it creates this gouge into which the ink will sit. The void that he is creating is done with a dry point, and they're both directly on the copper. It's either a push or a pull, and the dry point is a pull. It's a very sharp point. It's almost like you're drawing freehand, but it's kicking up a little metal burr as you're dragging it. So you've got a push and a pull. When you're pulling and you kick up this little burr, it creates this little feathery sort of kick up of copper as you do it. And so when you go to print it, those little feathery burrs will hold ink, and you get this kind of soft feathery line. And so he's done something really interesting, which is that he's describing an impossibility in dry point and a physical thing in engraving, which is kind of cool. But when you start thinking about the effect and how the lines look, you might imagine that the feathery kind of vaporous line might describe the thing that isn't there, which in this case actually could be both things. It could be the hand, it could be the void. And he's using engraving, which is usually very sort of crisp and clear and structured, and something you might think would be used to describe a solid, to describe this hand that isn't there either. So you have a both and print. It is both there and not there, both elements. So it's a very kind of mystical and sort of thought-provoking image about artistic creation, and it's one of my favorites.